Rob Jenkins. So Rob Jenkins is a representative of Unicef Florida, joined Unicef in 1995. He brings over 20 years of experience in international development programming in Africa, Asia, and the Middle East. Prior to his appointment, Mr. Jenkins served as the Deputy Director, Division of Policy and Strategy in Unicef headquarters from 2009 to 2014. In this position, he provided leadership in the development of UNICEF's strategic plan, global program approaches, and policies. From 1995 to 2009, Mr. Jenkins served with UNICEF in program and management positions in Uganda, Bangladesh, Myanmar, India, and Mozambique. Mr. Jenkins earned a Doctor of Education degree from the University of Bath and a Master's degree from the London School of Economics in the United Kingdom. Mr. Jenkins is married and has a daughter and son that go to ACS, and he's a Canadian citizen. I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Jenkins.
Great, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for this time that we had together. My understanding is I'm supposed to talk a bit about how I got into this life and my background, and I'm happy to do that. I also would like to talk a little bit about what UNICEF does in Jordan and also in responding to the crisis, meaning the Syria crisis. So before we move into that, I just want to set the scene a little bit with a song. It's 3 minutes, so you can just relax and enjoy it. A little bit of background. This UNICEF Jordan also responds to, we respond to the crisis happening here in Jordan, which we'll talk more about. We also respond to the crisis in Syria through cross-border work, meaning assistance that goes across from Jordan into Syria to places that are inaccessible to the government of Syria. This video was filmed about a month ago with colleagues by UNICEF in Syria. One of our programs in Jordan and in Syria is psychosocial support. And psychosocial support means working with kids that have been affected by the conflict, affected by the crisis, and now are suffering from a certain level of trauma. And so we engage with those children, we enable them to play again, we enable them to express themselves, and by doing so, hopefully dealing with this trauma. So this is when the song itself, the process of developing the song and singing the song was part of the psychosocial support. All the kids that are singing are all internally displaced people within Syria and are currently living in informal settlements, tents basically, on the edge of rural Damascus. So 3 minutes. Where's my phone right now?
Thank you.
And why, one of the many reasons why I think I've got one of the best jobs in the world is to be able to interact with kids like that and meet kids like that. Incredibly resilient, incredibly hopeful, despite the challenges they face. And there are hundreds of thousands of kids like that. The Syria crisis is unique for two reasons. One is the sheer scale of the crisis. This is the first ever that we deal with these kind of numbers, and they're numbers that don't really make sense anymore. 11 million displaced within Syria. Here we have 1.3 million Syrians living in Jordan. It's the first or second most highly populated refugee population in the world here. Just the sheer scale. So UNICEF uses the term no lost generation to mean that such a scale, we may lose a generation of people. Meaning if we do not address and respond at the scale that is required, we will have a whole layer of children that will never be able to recover, a whole generation. The second reason why the Syria crisis is so unique is it's just gone on far too long. One of the reasons why that video was released just last week is it's the sixth anniversary, 6 years. And so it is just too long. Hence the no lost generation. Any questions or comments of the video? Any immediate reactions? Yeah.
How long did it take for the video to be made?
About 6 weeks. It was a quick and dirty kind of thing. Yeah.
Are any of the people in the video or singing in the video actually refugees?
They're all internally displaced people, all those kids. Do you know anybody know the difference between an internally displaced person and a refugee? Yeah.
Internally displaced means that they don't have a home within the country, and a refugee went to fled for shelter in another state.
Cross the international border, exactly. So every child in that video is an internally displaced person. They're no longer living in their homes. Many of them are no longer living with their parents, but those who are living with their parents are also living in informal tented settlements in rural Damascus, supported by UNICEF and others. Okay, let me spend a little bit more time talking about UNICEF in Jordan, but I'm not going to speak too long. I want to respond to anything that you want to talk about and any questions you may have. I'll be honest, my purpose from this, my own selfish purpose, is that you are more aware of what's happening in the region and want to become more involved. That's my objective by 3 o'clock. So, UNICEF in Jordan. First of all, what does UNICEF stand for? What is UNICEF? Anybody? Who's heard of UNICEF?
International.
Okay, great. So what have you heard? What words jump to mind? Yeah.
And helps children.
Helps children, great.
United Nations?
It's the United Nations, exactly. The first two letters, UN, stand for United Nations. That makes us a little bit different than some others, exactly, yeah.
It provides aid to people who are in trouble.
It provides aid to some people who are in trouble, great. Anything else? Good, those are good associations, and it makes me happy to hear those associations. That's why I think I have one of the best jobs in the world. I've been fortunate enough to work for UNICEF for more than 20 years. And honestly, I can genuinely say, getting out of bed every morning to work for an organization that helps kids and tries to do our little bit to make the world a better place, not many people get to do that. And that's a real privilege that I do not take lightly. Okay, so some background on the crisis here. So we have 655,000 UN-registered refugees from Syria living in Jordan today. That's of the 1.3 million or so Syrians in total that live in Jordan. About half are children. That's roughly like it is in many other crises around the world. Now, the unfortunate situation, one of the main messages, is the situation amongst the Syrian refugees in Jordan is getting harder. It's harder to meet their minimum basic needs. Similarly to other neighboring countries to Syria, and definitely the case within Syria itself, the situation continues to get more and more difficult. One of the indicators, one of the reasons, one of the ways that it expresses itself, why we think things are getting harder and more difficult, is, you can see, more children are getting married. Right, and I saw somebody go, what does he mean by that? What do you think I mean by that? What is more children getting married? It means that more girls are getting married who are less than 18 years of age. And that's a problem. That's a big, big problem. And it's an expression of desperation of caregivers, of parents. And so we're now doubling from 18 to almost doubling to 35% in the last 3 years of marriages that involve one Syrian is to a girl less than 18. It's never the boys that are less than 18. It's always the girls that are less than 18. That has many, many implications to girls, as you can imagine. It has health implications. It also has, as you can imagine, long-term implications about them being able to realize their own vision and their own dreams and their own potential. So that's something that UNICEF takes very seriously. From a legal point of view, we take it seriously, and the government of Jordan and ourselves work very closely together to work on the legal system around early marriages. But in the end, it's about desperation. In the end, it's about needing more support. And because by increasing, we can see that more and more families are struggling to meet their basic minimum needs. And this is one way of expressing it. Another way that we see is worrying, that is showing that the increased vulnerability, is increasing numbers of children that are working. Now, working for an hour or two a day in the afternoon to learn some skills, it's actually something I did. I come from a small town in northern Canada. So we worked after school, that's okay. It's when it switches over to a term called child labor, that's when it's a problem. And child labor means, by definition, it is either too long in a day or the type of work they do affects the child in a negative way. That's the difference. That's a problem. And that's something that we also feel very strongly about and something that we fight against. So again, we come to the legal system. It's illegal to do that. It's illegal for an employer to employ a child laborer. However, it's also about expressing vulnerability. It's, what else can I do as a parent? Why there's an increase in child labor is because it is somewhat safer for Syrian refugees to send a 14-year-old out to work than it would be for me to work illegally. And because I can, hopefully, the legal system does not come down as hard on me if I'm caught as a child laborer, unlike an adult. Yeah?
What does UNICEF do to stop the child labor and the child marriage?
Great. So the question, if anyone can hear, is what is UNICEF doing to solve these two problems? So in two ways, really. The first is to try and work with the government, including the legal system and the education, etc., to enable, to work in a way that stops that practice from, so it means working with employers, working with the families themselves, to enable them to have other choices. The second is, we try and give them enough support, families, so that they don't have to make that difficult choice. And so what does that support look like? We have opened up a whole new school system, basically, through double-shifted schools. In the afternoons, now 200 schools in Jordan host kids in the afternoon. When the morning shift closes, they open up another school in the afternoon so kids can come to school. We also provide cash support. 55,000 children receive cash support for us every month. And that's hopefully a way that they can then negotiate that they can continue to go to school and not have to enter the labor market. Let me come to just a few more stats. Violence is a growing issue in the Middle East in general. It continues to be a significant issue here. Violence affecting children, both within the home as well as in schools. The violence within schools is corporal punishment, meaning teachers disciplining children in a violent way, verbally or physically, but also between kids. So that's an issue that we're still working on, and we can come back to how. And early childhood education, is also a key issue that we're trying to expand. What is early childhood education? Any ideas what that means? Early childhood education? Yeah. Preschool and nursery. Why do you think that's important? Exactly. It builds basic school, the basic skills, what we call readiness for school. It means that I can enter a school at 5 years old ready to be successful. And globally, the evidence around early childhood education is more and more recognizing how critical that intervention is, particularly for vulnerable kids. Jordan is the second most water-scarce country in the world, and so we need to utilize every single drop of water. Now, you wouldn't normally maybe think of UNICEF as a water agency because we are directly related to children, but from years and years and years ago, back in the 1950s, we became involved in that sector, mainly because it was one of the main reasons why children were getting sick was because they were drinking unsafe water, particularly in Africa and South Asia. So UNICEF became involved in that sector and now we're leading that sector. And we have been for decades. And in Jordan, it's absolutely critically important. It's hard to get a sense of the scale of, and water is directly related to this in Jordan, but maybe think of this. You live in a village in northern Jordan. Before the crisis, there are villages that were a population of 3,000. Now, they're 12,000. The balance, the difference, are the influx of refugees. So the pressure on the water system is enormous. And so we're trying to figure out a way to ensure that we still protect the original residents and getting enough water, but also enabling refugees to access enough water to meet their basic needs. So I mentioned the increasing vulnerabilities. And I mentioned what we call negative coping mechanisms. That's child labor, early marriage, etc. Let me now move. Youth, like yourselves, we think is one of the key partners in addressing this crisis and working together to address this crisis. Fortunately, the Middle East is a very young population. Over 70% of the population is under 30. That's exceptional. However, unemployment rates in this country are amongst the highest in the world. So that adds an additional challenge. It also means that we're not realizing the full potential of all that incredible resource. And so we are trying to figure out a way to harness that potential, either by expanding the labor market or in providing other opportunities for them to become properly engaged. So here's UNICEF, here are the programs that we do in the kingdom, in Jordan. And I mentioned this brand or this phrase, No Lost Generation, and why. I'm gonna show another video now. Education is one of our key initiatives. I mentioned about the expanding school system, etc. There's an important initiative called the Makani Initiative. Makani in Arabic means my space. It's a safe place to learn and realize my potential. We have over 230 in the Kingdom of Jordan, and they're open to all children, basically all vulnerable children who live in the neighborhood. They come and they learn, and they are supported with psychosocial support, life skills, etc. But you know what's most exciting about these centers, and it's a little like this Compassion Summit, it's bringing kids from different backgrounds together. So if you go to one of these 230 centers, like some of them are within a mile or two of here, you will see Syrians and Palestinians and Iraqis and Jordanians and other nationalities and disabled kids, able-bodied kids, etc., all interacting with each other and learning that diversity is actually a strength. And that's one of the key objectives of Makani centers. It's not only each individual child that comes. And child can lean all the way up to 18 in this case, but also it gives them an opportunity to interact with each other who they normally wouldn't be interacting with in their communities. So So here is a video, a little bit more.
UNICEF initiated the Makani approach in 2015 to provide all vulnerable girls and boys in Jordan in or out of school to access informal learning, psychosocial support services, and life skills training, all under one roof.
So the Makani model offers cost-effective multi-sectoral services to girls and boys and young people and women in a safe environment that helps improve their safety, their health and well-being, as well as to provide young people in Jordan with skills to help them shape their future. There are currently over 225 Makani centres spread across the country in refugee camps as well as urban centres and communities.
From UNICEF, but it's through a whole stream of 21 partners throughout the kingdom. And like I said, what's most exciting is kids interacting with other kids that they wouldn't normally get a chance to interact with. This is the other worrying thing that's happening in the Middle East, is there are many that are trying to further separate communities by their identities, by their status, by their beliefs, by their religion, by what they look like, by their gender. And so we're trying our best to actually break down those barriers and counteract. How successful do you think we are? What do people think about the last few years thinking of your own day-to-day life? Do you think the Middle East is becoming more inclusive or less so? Are we swimming against the tide or are we swimming with it? Yeah.
In terms of inclusiveness, I think that's kind of motivating us to become more inclusive and bring people together as we see our brothers and sisters evolve.
So you see it as motivational, the challenges, right? Yeah.
I think like the Middle East is slowly becoming more progressive. But I think it's not doing it at a fast enough rate, and I think that's because of a lot of like the limitations that it's generally been having that are also like cultural and traditional as well.
It needs to speed up.
Yeah. Right?
What ideas do you have on how we can speed it up? What else can be done? Yeah.
I guess if other nations took it as an initiative and focused more on like making sure that the Middle East developed, because I don't know if it has like the resources in itself to actually, you know, move itself forward.
You think it's more about within households, parents, or you think it's more about schools, or is it more about what about other things? What should we focus on if you were advisors to UNICEF, as you are? Yeah.
I think we would focus on the parents, because the parents have a lot of influence on the children, and children can't do stuff without their parents allowing them.
Focus on parents. I'm not sure everybody can And focus on parents, what would work? How do we reach all parents? Yeah.
I think the thing is they need education. Like not just the parents, but everyone. They need to get the education they need to know how to like act out and what they're supposed to do instead of making the wrong choices.
I think you're right. What do you think about children acting as agents of change with their parents? Meaning coming home, like many of you probably do, I would imagine, and encouraging your parents to think in different ways. Possible? Do any of you do that? Kind of? Are you successful?
Kind of.
Kind of successful. I think that's critically important. Children being acting as agents of change, interacting between each other and then coming home. And let me just be honest and open. In our many of our Makani centers, you'll see Jordanian kids interacting with Syrian refugees and go, it's the first time I ever interacted with them. Met a Syrian kid, become friends. You'll see actually another video in a second on that. And could they then come home and go, look, you know, there are people that are living just down the street that are very much like us. And we can work together. Yeah.
You can also work on changing the government's point of view on people. Because if the government is more accepting to children, children would be more willing to spread their word, like to speak out their opinion.
I think you're absolutely right. There's a government role in this. That was the comment. We have to work with the government. There is a concept that UNICEF feels very strongly about, and it's that there are people with rights, and those rights mean that there are others that have duties, have obligations. So there are rights holders, and there are duty bearers, people that bear the obligation to those children. All of you have rights. You have the right to education, you have the right to health care, you have the right to food, you have the right to participate and speak your mind. There are, because you have those rights, as enshrined in the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which, by the way, is the most ratified convention globally. There's no other convention of any other UN instrument that is ratified as much as the Convention of the Rights of the Child. And Jordan has ratified the Convention of the Rights of the Child, as my country has, Canada. So that legally means you have rights. So in a way, you're carrying that convention around in your back pocket, as every refugee child is. And that means that their parents, their community leaders, the government, the police, have obligations to realize their rights. And what is an obligation? An obligation means they have to do all that they can to enable those rights to be realized, for those children to enjoy those rights. So that also means organizations like UNICEF, or part of my job is to demand that that happens, but it's part of your job also. And it's part of all your friends' jobs, is to demand your rights are fully realized. That's an obligation of yours. Yeah?
I'm an Arab. I can understand what you're talking about, because the way we raised up, it's really different the way the Westerns is raising it. Girls especially, you cannot express your feelings, you cannot express what you need exactly, and to educate the parents in this point, it's really very hard. Even for me to raise up my kids differently, it took me, and still taking me a lot, to understand that they have freedom, they have their own opinion, so...
I think it's an excellent comment you've made. And I'm glad you shared it. I really appreciate that. I think the key is, at least if tomorrow is slightly more, is slightly improved than today. We recognize that it may be a long-term perspective we require, but as long as we move in forward in the right direction,
and that's it. And plus, you cannot cancel their identity. It's a little bit hard. You still need to keep their identity, their religion, their culture.
Absolutely.
But to be more open-minded to have freedom, to give your kids freedom and the children to express themselves.
Absolutely. Excellent point. So I mentioned early childhood. Let me just pass on through that. I've mentioned also about the importance of reducing violence and the need to address violence. And I want to just again highlight youth, recognizing that's the age group here in this room. I mentioned before, Jordan and the Middle East in general is a young population compared to among the youngest population in terms of regions in the world, and it means we have incredible capacity to change the future. Let me show another video about interacting with you.
أنا اسمي يوسف سليمان الصمادي من سوريا عمري 19 سنة كان في زي اختلاف ثقافات واختلاف العادات واختلاف الأفكار هاي بتأدي إلى مسألة تجانس منيح بين المجتمع الأردني والمجتمع السوري. أنا كنت إنسان كثير عصبي ما أحب أختلط مع ناس خاصة مصر أي حد يقبل عليك لو كنت احتمال إذا أقدم عليه بطل تعرفت على يوسف من خلال أحد الأنشطة اللي كان ضمن الجلسة ممكن أن نشعر بطريقة شوي لأنه طلبوا مننا نرسم شو الأشياء اللي نحبها فرسمتي كانت مقاربة لرسمة يوسف
فطلعت على الرسم فحكيت أن هذا الشخص عقله مثل عقلي بالضبط أنا بحب أيمن عشان هو اللي صار عقلي يفهمني عشان أيمن صار يفهمني تقريبا أكثر من أخوي صراحة
بس يعني من الأشياء اللي أحبها كثير فيه إنه هو حكيم بيقدر الشخص اللي قباله حتى لو كان يختلف عنه مثلاً شو ما كان في اختلافات بيناتهم وكان طيب كثير طبعاً كثير أنا أعمل أشياء مع يوسف بس أكثرها إنه إحنا بنلعب كرة قدم مع بعض بنروح على القهوة نتبادل الزيارات
لما يكون في عندك شخص يفهم أكثر منك يزيد هذا الشيء ويزيد الصداقة أكثر أنا الحمد لله
موجود عندي معاي. طبعا لازم تكون علاقة قوية ما بين الأردنيين والسوريين لأنه احنا عايشين نفس المجتمع. طيب لما المجتمع يكون قوي لازم احنا علاقتنا تكون مع بعض قوية.
We see it every day when you get a chance to interact with people you wouldn't normally. I should say, when people think of refugees, they often think of tents and living in remote locations. That's actually not the case for the vast majority of refugees living in Jordan. The percentage of refugees living in urban centers is But there's 82%, the vast majority of refugees are living near this school, or living in Amman, or living in other big cities, Mafraq, etc. Only the remaining 18% are living in two large refugee camps, Zaatari and Azraq. Zaatari being one of the largest refugee camps in the world, about 80,000 people. And like I said before, at the beginning, one of the challenges that the refugees, in particular in refugee camps, are facing here is just how long it has gone on for. They're now living, the kids living in the oldest child that we have now living in Zaatari that was born in Zaatari, it's 5.5 years old. They were 5.5 years old and they were born in the camp. their entire first 5 years of their life is living in a refugee camp, in a caravan of refugee camp. Hence the need for us to look at this no lost generation concept. Yeah.
Are the children in those refugee camps offered education?
They are. Yeah, UNICEF provides all the schooling in those camps, and the enrollment is relatively high. The challenge in education in the camps is what happens when I graduate. That's when we're currently now, if you're 17, 18, you do well in the national exam called the Dajihi exam in Jordan. There are limited opportunities to continue school. So that's one of our biggest challenges now. Yeah.
And like, what about labor in those camps? Are they more prevented in those areas?
So it is a more controlled environment. So extreme forms of labor we can prevent. But there are a lot of kids working, and not making that distinction between working and child labor again. And there are still kids that are tipping over into child labor and dropping out of school. The main thing for child labor to do in both Zachary and Azraq is to be a porter, to carry things. You either carry gravel or you carry grocery, you carry things for people. Any other questions about the camp or what life could be like there? It's actually a little like the girl, maybe one of the messages or the impression you got from the girl singing at the very beginning. I think many of you would be surprised at how hopeful and how optimistic and how dynamic the kids are at refugee camp. It's amazing that just how they see their lives will be better someday in the future and how they're willing to continue to engage. Yeah.
I believe when the life becomes tighter, the people will have more hope to get out of this.
When the life becomes
tighter.
Right. Yeah, the reality of refugees, obviously living in camps and in Jordan, is unfortunately the people that are making the decisions on whether they can go home or not is not them. It's others. And currently in Syria, it has never been more dangerous. So last year in 2016, we did have a few weeks that a few people felt like it was safe enough to return to some parts, but that has basically stopped now. Yeah.
What about
healthcare in the camps? What happens with access to education? So both in the refugee camps and in the urban centers, the UN, UNICEF, and the UNHCR, we work together actually on that, provide healthcare. We provide healthcare to children, and UNHCR provides healthcare to adults. In urban areas, how it actually works is when someone wants to go to a hospital, then we reimburse the cost to the hospital itself. Okay, let me just spend a few final minutes on water, sanitation, hygiene. I mentioned that before. We do have a unique situation. Maybe you get a sense from me now, I don't know, but we work in the system, we work in school systems, health systems, the juvenile justice system, but we also are providing assistance to those children that are in the most remote locations that you can imagine. We support 300 trucks delivering water a day in the kingdom. Many of them driving 100 kilometers across the desert to reach the border of Jordan and Syria, where there is a large population that needs water. So this is particularly sad and particularly troubling that after 6 years of the conflict, we are still at the very cutting edge of life-saving assistance. This is probably the most challenging operation that UNICEF's involved in globally because of the security nature of this, but also just the logistics. That video was taken a couple weeks ago. When it rains in the desert, which is the border, where that is the border of Jordan, Syria, and Iraq. You can see how challenging it is. Those trucks have traveled, yeah, those in particular, 110 kilometers through the desert like that. And again, this is 6 years into a crisis. So this is the sort of life-saving part of the work of UNICEF. To be honest, we would like to move out of that work. We're absolutely committed to realizing the rights of those children and to continue, but children themselves should not be living in that environment. That's why we're not happy with that. Yeah.
In the environments that you're talking about near the border, is there a decrease in refugees, or is it like staying steady, or is it increasing?
So that population right there is staying steady at about 60,000, 55,000 people. It will only decrease once Syria becomes more stable. And that needs to happen sooner than later. Yeah?
Do you get the water from rivers?
So we have drilled the boreholes, they're called. It's those huge tower trucks that come and you drill deep into the ground. In the case of Jordan, it's a half a kilometer down, and then you pull the water out from the aquifer and you deliver it from the closest aquifer. It's a good question. Okay, I do have a couple more slides. I'll talk a little bit about how I ever got into this area of work. I mentioned we do provide direct assistance. We're trying to move more and more in this direction, because even if the schools are open and they're good quality and the healthcare is good quality and I can access water and nutrition, etc., I obviously still need, as a parent and as a child, some basic minimum levels of support, even just for food, let alone rent, etc. So we are increasingly providing direct cash support globally as well as in Jordan. And so it works out, we're currently providing about $20, American dollars, 20 JD to 55,000 children. I know those 55,000 sounds like a lot of kids. It's nowhere close to the need, but it's all that we can afford, frankly, every month. What's interesting is, that is cash support that the parents can do what they want with. It's not that they must do something. But then we go back and interview them and we monitor it closely, and over 95% of the money that the parents get for their children is spent directly on their children. Even the remaining 5% is somewhat for their children, in that it's for food for the household. But we message the money to, that's a child grant for your children. And like I said, even if the parents there's no obligation, it's cash, they spend it on their children, enabling them to go to school, healthcare, etc. A neat thing that maybe some of you will like, I think, is we provided an innovation, which is the top right. The refugees come up to an ATM machine and they say, "I don't have a card." They push on the screen on the UNICEF, they lean forward and their eyes are scanned. The machine scans their eyes and that's how they identify who they are. And in 3 years of running this program, we have not yet found a case where it's misidentified. It's unlike fingerprints, which we do in other countries, except identify, this is completely foolproof. So then they say, "Hi, whoever it is," and they give the cash from the machine. So it's an innovation that is taking place. Why we think that's really important is because we want to make sure the people are getting the money, the people who are supposed to get. How we chose the 55,000 is through an assessment of their vulnerability. We visit their households and we find out how vulnerable they are. And vulnerable basically is what you'd expect. It's either child-headed households, meaning there's no adult in the house at all, or single-headed households with lots of children, or disabled, and people that are unable to access the labor market. They're the ones that are prioritized. We also a couple of other innovations I can mention is we introduced They're not actually iPads, but close enough, inexpensive to the Connie centers to enable children to learn quicker, and that's proving to be effective. Let me also mention something that I think is really neat in initiative is we're calling them innovation labs, and basically it's bringing youth together, discussing their community and the issues that are important to them, and finding out and working through a process to find their own solutions. That's what's happening on your right side. Yeah.
What is UNICEF's source of income?
So how do we pay for all this? UNICEF has two main sources. One is governments, basically the wealthy governments in the world, Germany and Norway and Canada and the United States, etc. And the second source is from private individuals and companies. And that's a little unique for a UN agency. Most UN agencies, or actually almost all UN agencies, are exclusively government funded. But UNICEF is about 40% funded by individuals and private companies. Let me, I think there is one more video, right, hang on.
My name is Hamid. I'm from Syria. Homs. I'm 17 years old. It's about violence and family problems. It talks about everyone. We found a lot of families have problems like that. We need the people to see the play and share their problems. We need to make it a good play, because we need the confidence. Left the school about 5 years ago, since the war started in Syria. I want to continue my education. I want to be more than just a girl. I want to be important in life. Yeah. That's all. The biggest challenge, stay alive, Salah, Salah, stay alive, to stay alive, here.
I really like that. I want to be more than just a guy, I want to be important in life. I think it's a really great mission, which we see over and over for the refugees and other volunteers in the camp. Okay, any... So maybe it's not that interesting, but a little bit more about myself. So I, like I said, I come from a small town in northern Canada, about 2 hours north of Toronto. In 1992, I left Canada as a volunteer, went to a small country in southern Africa called Lesotho. It's a tiny little kingdom surrounded by South Africa. And basically never went back to Canada then, other than to visit as on holiday. So since that time, I've been either getting more schooling in the United Kingdom or been working for UNICEF. This is my seventh country that my wife and I and our kids live in. We move every 2-3 years. And like I said, it's an incredible privilege to be able to represent this organization and to work with these kids and to try and change the system and to work with communities to realize these rights that I've been talking about. So it's an amazing experience. And hopefully some of you would like a similar experience. And if so, there'll be lots of opportunities for you. I should go. Any final questions? Me, UNICEF, the kingdom, yeah.
Is there any particular career that you suggest that might like prepare you for a career in UNICEF? I mean, any particular degree in like college or education?
You know, we have a full range of different skill sets that work. In Jordan, there's about 150 staff. And we have doctors and teachers and engineers and psychologists. The technical background is less important. I think it's more just the commitment and the kind of being mission oriented, if you'd like. Yeah.
Which countries have you lived in previously?
So, which countries was the question? So I started in Lesotho. I worked in Somalia during the war. During that war, that was 1993-94. Uganda, Burma, now called Myanmar, Bangladesh, India, Mozambique. Yeah.
What made you join UNICEF, like 20 years ago?
So, it was a very strange, I kind of fell into UNICEF. I didn't fall into a profession that was to fight the good fight, as I can say. I was always committed, I was always passionate about wanting to be involved in some way of working with people that would hopefully make a contribution to being better. But, my father was a small town lawyer, and so I was groomed to follow his footsteps and go to law school. And after I finished my master's degree, before I started my doctorate, I was a good son. I applied to, that's after a year in Africa, I applied to law school and was accepted, and also competed for a job in UNICEF, and literally had both pieces of paper. So Dan was very fortunate at that stage, and had many hours of discussion with my wife and I, except at that time, going, do we go back and work in Canada, or do we continue on in international life? And at that point, we felt we could make a greater contribution overseas. So I don't know if I mentioned my string of countries. I spent 2 years in Uganda in the mid-90s, 95 to 97. After that is when I moved to Uganda for UNICEF. But it doesn't, I feel working for UNICEF, traveling around the world, it's more obvious and maybe there's more resources to make an impact. But it doesn't mean I couldn't have also made an impact in my small Canadian town as a small town lawyer as well. So that part I think was gonna remain consistent. It was just how to do it. What is the greatest thing about this job is, like I said, are the people I get to meet and interact with. And I am humbled every day by the resilience and commitment and perseverance to stay engaged and change the world. We wouldn't, if we could all get a bus now and go to, actually if we could follow those water trucks and go to that, to the berm, as we call it, between Jordan and Syria, something I do maybe every 3 weeks or so, you won't believe what you can see these 8, 9, 10-year-olds with their little writing books, trying to still learn how to read, and trying to contribute. It's humbling. It's a real privilege. Yeah.
So who and how they can join the UNICEF?
So I think they need a little more schooling, although I don't. Maybe just continue to do well in school. The thing is, you've got such a all of you have such an incredible, have so many more assets than many kids do. Not only kids like refugees, but even a small town Canadian. If you're already international by definition, look at the room full that we have here. Look at the languages that you speak and the openness that you have. So the foundations, I think, are already there. So my suggestion would be follow your passion. And then whether it's UNICEF or some other organization, but if you can commit, which was my objective, to try and at least add my 2 cents to, you can commit to making a positive difference in whatever field that may be. That's my 3 o'clock objective, is for all of you to commit to that. Yes, please.
Do people get paid or are they volunteers?
So I get paid.
Like in general.
In general, you would start with as a volunteer, generally, and that's what I did. You start with as a volunteer, and then you find a way to contribute in a way that meets your bills, and as I'm getting paid a little bit, and then you continue to. It's like in any career, frankly, not just a social career, but you start at an entry level, underpaid or not paid, and gain skills, improve yourself, and yeah.
At what age can you start these volunteers with UNICEF? With UNICEF?
So, it depends on where you live, and we have volunteers at all ages, including children that volunteer at these Makani centers, including my daughter, by the way, who's 16. She volunteers in the Makani center, but so do the refugees themselves. And so, our mission is not only to provide services to kids, but to give them an opportunity to participate. So, depending on where you live, etc., if you want to volunteer with UNICEF or any other organization, that would be possible. I don't want to overstep my time, but thank you so much for all your questions and your engagement, and even your decision to come to this summit. And it obviously shows a willingness to be open-minded and explore how you can contribute. And hopefully you've learned a bit about UNICEF and the situation here. There's lots of phenomenal organizations out there. There's lots of incredible professions to contribute to make the world a better place. So I wish you all the best in your incredibly bright future. Thanks everybody, thank you.
Okay, now it's break until 3:30, and at 3:30 you reconvene as a school. First speak to your supervisor or your chaperone, they know where you guys need to go, so you will. There's another 11 spots to figure out. So 11 schools, 11 spots to figure out. So to figure out where to go, you need to go to your supervisor. They know where you will be doing as a school. And that is at 3:30, so you have half an hour.